thanks for joining us. If you would, I'm just going to start off name and branch of service and the years you served and some of that basic information.
Okay. Well, my name is Thomas Owens, and I go by Tim. I was in the Army and was in the Army actually 3 years active duty and then 23 active reserves. Went in 1968 and retired in 1994.
It's a long time.
It was.
And what was your MOS while you were in?
I was actually, when I was in Vietnam, I was a 36 Bravo, which is a counterintelligence officer. They used to call it intelligence research officer, but it was counterintelligence. And then I had a secondary, the 11 Bravo infantry. And when I was in the reserves, I was a strategic intelligence officer, which was they changed the MOS on it, and I want to say it was a 36 Alpha, maybe something like that. I just don't remember what it was as a strategic intelligence officer.
And where are you from originally?
Well, that's kind of an odd question for an Army brat. I'm second generation military, and I was born in Watertown, New York, when my parents were both stationed there in what's now Fort Drum, used to be Pine Camp, New York. But my mother was from Kansas, and my father was from Newburgh, New York, right outside of West Point. So it's when you're an Army brat, you kind of travel around. I went to high school all 4 years in Junction City because my father was stationed at Fort Riley. So I guess that's as close to being hometown as anywhere.
So did you kind of know from an early time in your life that you were going to join the military?
You know, I guess I grew up assuming I was going to be in the military in some way or another because both my parents were. I was my mom's discharge papers because back then she was in the wax when my dad met her. And she couldn't be pregnant being in the military, so she got out and I was born. And I just assumed, I think, most of my life that at some point I was going to be in the military. Whether it was going to be a career or not was depending on how my life took, you know, what route it took. So I think that was just, you know, you kind of grow up thinking you're probably going to be something like what your parents are. And that's how I kind of felt back then.
At what point did you know?
Well, I started off in high school living at Fort Riley and being with a lot of other Army brats and going to high school with in Junction City was a mix. It's kind of an interesting community to be in. And I guess I kind of knew then that I initially wanted to be an Army chaplain. And that was because of the chaplain that we had there at Fort Riley was such an influence. But then I went to Kansas State University. My parents both went overseas at that point, and I went close to where I went to high school, and where I could be right near Fort Riley and get all the benefits of a military dependent. And I think when I went to Kansas State was when I really was deciding I was going to go through ROTC and I was going to get a commission and become a career Army officer.
And so you went in 1969.
I graduated in 1968 from Kansas State and got my commission on June 1st, 1968, and then I reported to active duty in September at Fort Benning, Georgia.
What was that like back then?
Reporting into...
Yeah, Benning. You know, there's a lot going on in the world that time.
Yeah, we used to call it Benning School for Boys. And it was the infantry school. And when I graduated with my ROTC commission, I was commissioned as military intelligence, which I had asked for, and I was able to get my first choice. And at that time, the military intelligence branch did not have its own basic course. So we were assigned, any military intelligence officers were assigned to a combat arms branch for primary basic training. And I happened to be assigned to the infantry school. So it was an interesting time because, like you say, Vietnam was it was in the middle of the Vietnam conflict. Mm-hmm. And so it was a time when a lot of people were anticipating going to Vietnam. And in fact, as I recall, I was the first cadet in my ROTC graduating class at Kansas State that year to have orders for Vietnam. I had them when I was still at school, I got my orders, and it was a list of go to infantry school, go to intel school, go on leave for 30 days, and go to Vietnam. And so that was pretty much the anticipation. And going to the infantry school, you know, the anticipation was, what are they going to do with me as far as a branch? And would I be going as an intel officer? Would I be going as an infantry officer? What was I going to be doing? So it was a lot of questions back then. And my wife and I got married, and I left for Fort Benning.
So you got married prior to going to training in Vietnam. So it's kind of right after school.
Well, then. Basically, I told her that we could wait until I got home. She said, no, we can't. So she was anticipating that, you know, she was going to be a military wife. And she said, no, let's get married. And so we got married, and I think, you know, two or three weeks later, I reported to Fort Benning. And then she joined me when I got finished with the infantry training at Fort Benning. And she went with me up to Fort Holabird, Maryland, which was at the time, it was the school for the intel training. It's now down at Fort Huachuca, Arizona, but back then it was Fort Holabird, Maryland. And so we went up there and went to 17 weeks training of counterintelligence training. And then she got pregnant. She was going to have our child, and I had to figure out, what are we going to do now? Because I had orders for Vietnam already. So I took her to the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, in Marquette, Michigan, at K.I. Sawyer Air Force Base, where my father was then stationed. After he got back from Vietnam, he went up there as the resident agent for Army Intelligence in the Upper Peninsula, and they were living at the air base. So I took her up there, and she was able to be there, and I'd left for Vietnam from there, and then our first son was born while I was in Vietnam.
What was that training like, the intelligence training? What was that training like back then?
Well, I thought it was fascinating. It was kind of an interesting place to be. We were in Baltimore, Maryland, but it was... I wasn't unfamiliar with it because my father was military intelligence, and I'd kind of grown up as part of that. He actually went into military intelligence when it first became a branch. And so I knew a little bit about what we were going to be doing, and it dealt with security clearances and that sort of thing. And so we were being trained for that, but we were also being trained for tactical intelligence. And tactical intelligence, obviously, being because we were going to Vietnam. And so we had that kind of training there with what to do when you get into a combat situation and you're an intel officer, what are you going to be doing there? So I was fascinated and learned a lot at Fort Holabird. And then, like I say, it was 30-day leave, and then I headed for Vietnam. I think my flight left for Vietnam May 14th, 1969.
And how long were you there?
1 year and 2 days, and I used to know the number of hours.
Was that Did you go there multiple times, or was?
I was just there one time. I was there for a full year, and I was there. I came home in May of 1970, and I happened to be assigned to downtown Kansas City, which was a culture shock coming from Vietnam and going to downtown Kansas City in the what was then 9/11 Walnut, and they changed the number after 9/11. They changed it. I think it's 900 or something like that, Walnut now, but we were on the 26th floor of a office building in the heart of Kansas City, so that was kind of a culture shock coming back from Vietnam and going to a high-rise in Kansas City.
Explain that to me. What do you mean by culture shock? How so?
Well, you're, you know, you spend a year and you're in a combat zone Vietnam setting, jungles, and the kind of setting that Vietnam is, and living in the kind of facilities that you live in, whether you're in the rear area and living in some kind of a little barracks-type building or in a little hooch, and if you're in the forward area, you might be living in a bunker, and then you come back and all of a sudden, you're back with family. You're in a urban setting. You're going to work in civilian clothes, which we were, and not really on a military base. And so it was just a very different kind of setting going from one to the other.
Were you still on active duty then, or were you on active reserve?
Active duty. I was active duty from. When I reported in 1968, in September, and then I got off active duty in August of 1971, and I had an opportunity to go to law school, and so I got off active duty and stayed with the active reserve then, and I was in the active reserves until I retired in 1994.
So did you go to law school?
I did.
Become a lawyer?
I did.
Where did you go to law school?
Washburn Law School in Topeka, Kansas.
It's a good school. I know some people that went through there. What was your objective, your mission in Vietnam?
Well, I was assigned to the 199th Light Infantry Brigade when I got there. And that was kind of an interesting circumstance. When I reported into the replacement station, I got assigned to 199 LIB, and I had no idea what that was. And they said, well, it's just up the road here, and you'll have a vehicle pick you up tomorrow. And so they did. They came and got me and took me, you know, up the road to Long Bin and to the 199th headquarters. And, you know, I went in, and the young man who was basically, he was a finance corporal. And he was there. He said, sir, he said, aren't you back then 9666 instead of 36? You know, it was 9666 was the MOS then. And I said, yes. He said, well, I think they want you to be an 11 Bravo. They're going to send you out to the 5th or the 12th Infantry, and you're going to be a platoon leader. I said, well, okay, I haven't been through any of that other than going through the infantry school. But so he said, I'm going to let the MI people know. And so he did, and then when I was sitting there going through the books on how to be a platoon leader G1 office, or it was a S1 office, actually, in a brigade. It was a separate light, separate brigade. I was going through the books, and they told me, well, you're going to be a platoon leader. We don't need you as an intel officer. In walked the commander of the military intelligence detachment that was assigned to the brigade. And he looked at me and said, are you Owens? I said, yes. He said, don't say anything. We do want you. And he said, they can't they can't send you out to do that if we need you. So I didn't say anything, and he went in and talked to them, and they weren't very happy about it, but I ended up being in my MOS, and there was a regulation at the time that said that you could not assign somebody with after 17 weeks of training in military intelligence in that kind of an MOS. They couldn't assign you to something else without the permission of the chief of intelligence in Washington, D.C. And so, absent their ability to do that, they weren't going to do that. So they assigned me, and I was assigned to the brigade MI detachment. And then I was the counterintelligence officer and in charge of security. And I ended up doing some rather interesting things as an intel officer, and I ran agent nets and that sort of thing. I had people that brought information in, and I briefed the general on enemy issues.
So tell us about that. What was that like? The nets and such, like.
Well, as much as I can say, basically I had people that indigenous personnel that had information and would give me information, and then I would incorporate it into what any battle plans or anything like that that the brigade. It was an infantry brigade, so they had platoons out, companies out, and they were doing combat missions. And so the information that we got as to where the enemy was and what they were doing was critical for their ability to find more things out. And then we had an interesting attachment to our detachment was the Kit Carson Scout Program, which was... they were basically expatriated VC that had come over, and they were in a unit, and they acted kind of like the old Western movies, you know, where you'd have Native American scouts that would go with the cavalry and whatnot. And that was how I would equate that. And so we would assign these people to particular brigades, and or not brigades, particular platoons, and they'd go out with them just like a scout, and they would help them understand what they were dealing with in their mission in combat. And we were responsible for those individuals being assigned to go out. And that was fascinating, learning from them, and they would teach us what not to do, you know, what to be careful for. And so that was a fascinating aspect of the job that I had.
Is some of this kind of like you see in the movies where they're developing assets and, you know, these clandestine meetings where you're meeting and they're giving you information and stuff like that?
Oh, I don't know that it's like the movies, but, you know, it's meeting with people you know, how do you compensate people out, you know, giving you information and that sort of thing. It was... At the ripe old age of 23, you know, here I am doing that sort of thing and meeting with people, and it was fascinating. I had an interesting job in Vietnam, and it was, but it was with the infantry, and it was, you know, we'd go to villages, and we would determine who was there that shouldn't be and who wasn't there that should be, and determining where is the enemy and over there, you know, it's hard to tell. Who is and who isn't, but you get information. One interesting story about that, I had an individual who was one of my sources who happened to be a security officer in his village. And I'd go out and meet with him, and I asked him if there was anything in particular that he needed. And he said, I don't want any money. I don't want anything like that, because otherwise they'll know that I'm doing something I shouldn't be, and they'll kill me. I said, well, what would you like to have? He said, I'd like to have those, you know, those tubes that your artillery shells come in, where they're shipped in. Can you get me any of those? I said, what do you need those for? He said, if you'll come to the village, I'll show you. So I went out to the village, and he showed me what he was doing. And what they did was they took those tubes, and they put them together in the village, and they created a sewer system for his village using the tubes from artillery cases. Not the artillery rounds or anything, but these were just the tubes that they packed them in when they shipped them. And I got a couple of deuce and a half truckloads of them and took them out there, and they put them all together. And it's amazing what you can do with just that sort of thing. But they made a sewer system in their little village that they didn't have before. So I felt good about, okay, that's a good thing. And it's a good use of materials that were going to be thrown away.
What was communication like with the family when you were in Vietnam?
I've got an interesting story on that. We obviously didn't have cell phones back then. We didn't have any kind of telephone communication other than the Mars station, which is military. I'm not sure what that stands for. It's an acronym for radio station. It was ship-to-shore communication, and they'd had a little shack or a little building there that they ran the Mars station out of, or our brigade rear area. And so you could make an appointment to go to the Mars station, and you had to set it up so that whoever you were calling was going to be ready to go on the other end, and you would be there in the little building, kind of like we're sitting in now, and just you'd be ready to talk. But you'd have to do it just like ship to shore, because it was, so you'd talk for a bit, and then you'd say, over. Then the other side would talk for a little bit, and they'd say, over, back and forth. And you just set that up, like I said, once in a while, you could get an appointment to go do that. The interesting thing was the Mars station was right next to the little officers' club that they had in the brigade headquarters. And so when we finished with your conversation with your significant other, who you might be talking to, you go back into the officers' club, and everybody applauded. And the reason they applauded was because on occasion, the speaker system in the officers' club would pick up the conversation from the Mars station. And so you'd be talking to your wife or somebody, and everybody would be listening to it in the officers' club. So, but everybody knew that, so it was just, it was one of those things, but it was kind of fun. But that was the communication we had. And the other was sending reel-to-reel tapes back and forth that you could mail. The other thing would be letters, sending letters. I still have all the letters that we exchanged, and I still have the reel-to-reels that we exchanged. So that was the communication back then. It was nothing like today with the cell phones.
You said you kept all those?
I did.
Do the reels still play?
I have to find a reel player. That's not easy to do either. But yeah, they would if I could get a reel-to-reel player that I could use. They're just little mailing reels. One of them I recall was the first time I heard my son make any noise. He was crying on there. Kind of the guy next to me in the little hooch that I had said, "Was there a baby crying in your room?" I said, "Yeah, it was my son. It was reel to reel, so I was playing that."
Would you keep each reel, or did you record over the reel to send it back?
No, I kept them. I'd get a new one and record and send it to family. And then they'd send them over to me. They'd send one to me. You just get them. It'd be like buying a disc nowadays or something, and you send it over. That was what we did. We just mailed them back and forth.
How long did it take usually to get your package back and forth?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. A couple of weeks probably. Maybe not that long.
Wasn't real fast, though.
No, it wasn't quick. Quick communication, but you know, we thought it was okay back then because that was what we had.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so this whole time, right, your wife is home with your newborn. What was her reflection on that time period?
Her reflection?
Yeah, like how, you know, as far as you going away, dealing with having a new baby, the lack of correspondence because the timeliness and stuff. And...
Well, I think, actually, I think having, she understood a little bit about the military because we were together for the 17 weeks at Fort Holabird and that sort of thing, and we talked a lot about it before we went. She knew I was going. It wasn't a surprise. You know, it was a decision that was made that we get married, first of all, and it was just a decision. She was ready for that. But then I think living with my parents, and my mother was an Army wife. I mean, she had been in the military herself, and she was, you know, I grew up as an Army brat. You know, it was just a way of life. And my father was in Vietnam. Like I said, my father, my brother, and I were all in Vietnam within 3 years. And while we were doing that, Mom was home. And so her experience in that was, I think, a benefit to my wife in understanding how things went. It wasn't easy, but she was there. She had, the OBGYN doctor lived across the street from Mom and Dad at KSR Air Force Base. So she had all those facilities. She was learning about the military, and she had Mom and Dad to teach her. And then when she had the baby, and her mother came up from Kansas, and they drove back down, and my wife went back to school at K-State. She wasn't finished yet. So she was there, and I think it just fit in, and it was a recognition, this is just the way it is. This is how we communicate. This is what the military's like. This is what it's like to be an Army wife. And so I think everybody handled it very well.
You mentioned that your brother and father both served in Vietnam, right?
Right.
Where was that? Was that before you, after you?
I was the third one to go. My father was the first one, and he left for Vietnam when I was at ROTC summer camp at Fort Riley, and came up to, you know, tell me goodbye, and he'd left from there. But he was sent over. He was in Tay Ninh, Vietnam, and working with Army Intelligence in that arena, 525th MI. While he was there, my brother was in the Marines, and he was assigned to Hawaii, and he was at Kaneohe, Hawaii, and his regiment or brigade, I don't know what they call the Marines, but he was sent to sea. They all went to sea on a training mission. They got to sea and got out there, and the announcement came out, well, we're not going back to Hawaii, we're going to Vietnam from here. So they went from there. They went out thinking they were going to be coming back, and they went to Vietnam. He went to Da Nang. And while he was there, he called my dad and said, hey, I'm here. My dad said, you're where? You don't have to be. You know, that's not required that members of the same family be in a combat zone at the same time. My brother said, well, I've been wanting to get here. This is what I became military for. And he said, I wanted to be here. So my dad said, well, I'm going home then. So he'd been there 10 months, and my brother actually ended up serving 10 months kind of back to back. And by the time they both got home, I had orders to go. So it was an interesting thing for Mom, you know, 3 years in a row having one of her three men in Vietnam.
I'm sure it was probably a pretty stressful period.
Yeah, she was a good Army wife. She understood.
So you come on orders to go to Vietnam, and your dad and your brother had already been there. Did they have any particular advice or words of caution, or were they, you know?
Not really. I didn't talk to my brother a whole lot about it, you know. My dad, like I said, I took my wife up to where they were stationed at K.I. Sawyer then, and I spent 30 days up there. And I guess the only thing I remember about kind of how that went, when I walked out to get on the airplane at K.I. Sawyer to leave, you get your pregnant wife and you got your mother and they're standing there and your dad, and he's been to Vietnam. He was standing by the gate, and the last thing I remember was him punching me in the arm. He said, "Come home." So that was about it. He knew. And they didn't know what I was going to be doing, didn't know where I was going to be going. And he knew what he'd done, he knew what my brother had done. And so, you take it in stride if you're a military family. Not easy, but you do it because that's who you are.
Did you and your dad and your brother ever reflect on your times together over there, or?
Some, not a whole lot, we talked a little bit about what we did, some of the experiences and some of the things we did, but we didn't live in the same place. I mean, my father was in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, and then they went to, later on, he was in the attaché's office in Wellington, New Zealand. So, they're overseas. My brother, he was in Houston, Texas, and I was in Kansas, so when you're not right together, you're not having these kind of conversations. So we didn't talk a lot about it, but we did a little bit. We knew about what each other had done, or a few little anecdotal stories that we would share.
See, when you came back to Kansas City and you got stationed here, it seems like that's an atypical duty station. What was that assignment? What were you doing in Kansas City?
Well, it's atypical for military, I suppose, but basically we were assigned to the 113th Military Intelligence Group out of Chicago, and they had duty stations in different cities, and what we did was background investigations for people getting security clearances. And then on occasion we would do criminal type investigations if it had to do with a security type situation, and that was what we were assigned to do. And I was the case control officer for Region 3 out of Kansas City, and we'd get requests in for background investigations for people getting security clearances, and I'd assign an agent to go out and ring doorbells, find out about who this person was, and were they a good risk for, having a security clearance at some particular level. So that was what we did, background checks and that sort of thing. And like I say, I was a case control officer for this region, and we worked out of the 26th floor of the 9/11 Walnut.
I would imagine that period of service was a lot more conducive to family life.
Sure, I mean, my wife and son were here, and so we lived in Johnson County, and became familiar with this area, and I just, go to work downtown just like a lot of other people in civilian clothes. We weren't in uniform. So it was just very much like going to a civilian office building. Then I had an opportunity to, I applied and I had an opportunity to go to law school. So I got off of active duty. I'd been on active duty for 3 years, got off active duty, and stayed with the reserves, but went to Topeka and went to law school.
So then, when you came back, you were active reserves, right? So you were still working full-time for the military.
Yes.
So did you have a law career? Did you do law with the military?
No, I actually thought, maybe I could go back in as a JAG officer after law school. about that time, you know, the war had wound down, and they didn't really need to have I was a captain. They didn't need to have a lot of people coming back in, especially in some of those branches where they had enough people. And I decided I didn't really need to do that. My wife wanted to come to Kansas City because we'd been here for a while. And I could be with the reserves, and I didn't have to go active. And so we made the decision to stay with the active reserves. And I actually found a slot in a intel unit, military intelligence unit, out of Lawrence and Leavenworth. And so that's where I went instead of going back on active duty. I went to that, and I wanted to stay with that. It was kind of like an avocation then. I was going to practice law. Why not have an avocation as an intel officer instead of being a JAG officer and kind of like a busman's holiday? You know, you do the same thing on military as you do with your day-to-day existence. So that's what we did, and it actually turned out to be a pretty good decision.
So the law degree kind of fit in with that then?
Oh, yeah, it didn't hurt at all. I mean, the law degree was a great degree to get. I mean, I went to law school with the idea, am I going to practice law? I don't know. But whatever I'm going to do, a law degree is a good broad base education to have. And so that's what I did. And, yeah, it helped my intel career. And as a strategic intelligence officer and studying the things that we did with that, and I can't go into a lot of detail with that, but we had some really interesting assignments as a small intelligence unit in Kansas. We operated out of basically the D.C. areas where we did our annual training and that sort of thing, and then the Foreign Science and Technology Center in Charlottesville, Virginia. So I got to do a lot of things that were very interesting.
Any of those you can tell us about?
One of the things we did do, we were alerted. Eventually, we were alerted. I was commanding the unit eventually as a full colonel, and we were alerted to go to Desert Storm. And our mission at the time had to do with knowing and having knowledge of foreign armor systems. So we studied that and were prepared to assist in whatever way we needed to in being the quote-unquote experts in armor systems. But other than that, I really can't probably go into a lot of detail about anything else that we did. But it was a great experience in having the ability to do something that was different than you do with your daily life.
So were you pretty much in that position or unit until you retired?
Yes.
And so then you retired out of, you're locally out of Kansas.
Right.
Didn't have to leave again or
no.
For any rank or change. I know some people in reserves to take a promotion or something, or they'll leave, you know, to go to another unit in the spot and move.
I didn't have to do that. And I was very fortunate in that respect. I mean, I had an offer. I could have gone to other places if I wanted to, but I didn't have any reason to do that. And I was doing other things at the time. I had, besides law career, and I was practicing law here, and in the general area here, in the counties here, I was, doing my intel work with the military intelligence in a reserve capacity. I was elected to the city council in Overland Park. And I didn't know at the time I was going to be there for 24 years, but I served for 24 years as a councilman here in Overland Park. And then the last 3 years of that, I was appointed to take our state representative's place in Topeka. And so I did both of those for that period of time, and I was a state representative for 3 years. Then I got elected to my own term. And so I served in the state, Kansas state representative. I served for 7 years, and then I ran for the state senate, and I was elected to the senate for 4 years. So I served 11 years in the state, 24 with the city. You know, was an Army intelligence officer in an active capacity in the reserves, and practiced law. So I was kind of a busy guy.
And are you still practicing law?
I'm retired, technically. I work under the umbrella of the Kansas Legal Services now in a program that the Kansas Supreme Court approved, and that is as a attorney emeritus. And I think, I tell people, I think that's Latin for old lawyer working free. What I do is I worked at the help center at the courthouse until the pandemic shut that down for a while. And I'm available through the Kansas Legal Services to do advice on certain things. And some of what I do, because of my military background, I help veterans out whenever I can. And I've helped other folks, just kind of more of a point people in the right direction, kind of help them out if I can and in some capacity or another. And if not that, then I know a lot of people, and so I can be a referral attorney. I can refer people. And that's worked out pretty well, but I don't get paid for doing that. That's a volunteer capacity that I do.
So from the regular workforce, you're retired, but you stay busy.
I try to, you know. I tell people I don't have to do anything, but I have to do something. Mm-hmm. So.
And you, I mean, it seems like you enjoy what you're still doing, right? Like,
most of the time. You know, if I'm doing something, I like challenges. I like to do something that's challenging. I like helping people. I've always done that. That's been, my whole life has been in some way or another doing what I consider to be helpful, helping people in some capacity or another.
So of all these different positions, what would you say you've enjoyed most in your career?
I think the thing I enjoyed the most was probably the time that I spent as a state senator. And part of what I did then was I was lucky enough to be appointed to chair the Senate Judiciary Committee, which of course pulled together the experiences that I had, you know, as a lawyer. And I really felt that was a great challenge, and I felt like, you know, we had done some good work, and I worked with a lot of really good people. I know a lot of the people, and it was a great experience. My service in the military and the various capacities that I had was challenging, it was interesting, and I think that was right up there. It's hard to say which is your favorite. You know, there were different things. There were different hats doing different things, but challenges and doing something that I felt was worthwhile. And then city council was interesting. It was a lot, like I say, it was a long time, but I watched the city grow. When I first got on Overland Park City Council, it was 1981. And I had left it in 2005. So we had 82,000 people in Overland Park when I first started, and there's now, 200,000 people in Overland Park. So you watch a city grow, and that's fascinating. I'm very proud. I have that son that was born while I was in Vietnam is now the city manager in Lawrence, Kansas. I'm very proud of that, and proud that he chose that as his career path of municipal government, which is a fascinating area to be involved in and to watch that, and it's close to the people, and it's amazing to watch a city grow. It's just, I don't know whether that answers your question. It's probably a long-winded lawyer answer, but.
Growing up an Army brat, and then being a career soldier, was there anything that you took from growing up and said, you know, I want to make sure I do this different for him, or also inversely, you know, I want to make sure that they have, you know, the same sort of experience, or, you know, did that impact being an Army dad? You know, maybe there were things that you particularly did like about being an Army dependent when you were growing up, or maybe also that you didn't. So did you make things, any decisions differently because of that experience when you were an Army father?
I don't know that I did anything different. I think probably, looking back on it now, maybe I was a little bit too strict. You know, I was a military guy. You know, we had things that, you know, you do things in a certain way, you know, and probably a little OCD, you know, it just, you know, and your kids grow up with that sort of thing. I don't know that they always appreciated that a whole lot, but we had rules, and you follow rules and you do things, but both of our sons are very, very dedicated, hardworking, and I think they learned that from their mother as, you know, she had a career in the insurance industry. They watched both of us have these careers and be involved, and both of them learned a good work ethic. And I think part of that for me was because I was in the military. I grew up in a structured environment, and things are done in a certain way. You just live life and you live according to rules, you know. And I suppose, you know, that sometimes can be helpful and sometimes can be an impediment. But I think both of our sons have handled it very well. Our other son lives in Austin, Texas, and works for basically a wholly owned subsidiary of Audi Corporation, and it does very well. Both of our sons have three children. They're doing very well. And so I'm very proud of that. But I think they've earned that on their own accord by their hard work ethic So I don't know whether that really answers your question, but that's...
And your experience may have been a little different than yours too, right? Because you were largely in one spot for a lot of their life, as they were older, right?
Right, yeah.
I think yours was more the traditional moving around a lot and whatnot until
As a child, I went to 9 different schools. I was fortunate enough to end up... like I said, I went to all 4 years of high school in one place, which is rare for an Army brat. But I was fortunate enough to do that. Our sons grew up here. It was a great place to have a family, and they both went to the Shawnee Mission School District, and they both got great college educations. It was always important. Education is very important. Structure is important. Good work ethic.
So you spent a lot of time in the K-State, Junction City, Riley area there, right?
I did. I went to high school for 4 years, and then my last year, my father actually got sent overseas to Okinawa, and my mother stayed. We moved into Junction City from Fort Riley to let me finish high school. And then she joined my dad. She and my brother joined my dad in Okinawa. And because I was here, now my grandparents lived in Newton, Kansas, so it wasn't that I didn't have any family here. But because of that, then Kansas State was a good place to be because it was next to Fort Riley. I could use all of the veterans or being an Army brat and a dependent, I had all of those facilities, medical, dental, exchange kind of things that the military post provided right next to where I went to college. So it was very convenient for me to do that. And it had an ROTC there, so everything was fitting together. So 4 years in high school, and then I squeezed 4 years into 5 at K-State. So I was in that general area for, 9 years.
When it also had the added benefit of not having to be a Jayhawk, right? You got to be a Wildcat. And I'm just kidding.
I can't say a whole lot about that because I have a son who is now the city manager of Lawrence, Kansas. I have a grandson who wears a Jayhawk shirt a lot. So, and my son in Lawrence actually got his master's in public administration at KU, which, in my opinion, is one of the paramount management training programs in the world. It's just a phenomenal program. And so he got his degree there. So, you know, we're all Kansans.
I was asking that because I was curious of your reflection on how much that has changed from, you know, I'm sure it's, there's a lot more infrastructure, and, you know, just what is that like from back then to today, that, you know, that area and Riley and massive changes or?
You know, I don't know that I can address that a whole lot. You know, it's still the home of the 1st Infantry Division, and it's a divisional, you know, military post. And Junction City's grown. Manhattan has grown. You know, they've both expanded. And from that perspective, I guess it's just growth over the years. You got more people, but... Fort Riley it's going to be there. I don't think it's not been one of those posts that's been looked at very carefully about any kind of closing. So it's a divisional post. That's pretty critical. And
It was also Big Red One back then?
Yes.
As well, yeah, that's not changed?
No. My dad was he was actually in the first MI when he was stationed at Fort Riley. He was with the military intelligence, but he was in the 1st Division Military Intelligence Unit. So, yeah, Big Red One was there at that time.
I think that says a lot, because a lot of large units move. And, you know, just during my lifetime, I've seen a lot of them move. You know, 4th ID and...
Well, the 4th ID is still in Washington?
Carson now,
and it was at Fort Hood.
When they joined us in Iraq, they were coming from Fort Hood. And I was my first unit was 3rd ACR, and it moved to Fort Hood, and that was at Carson then.
Yeah, back then when I first went to Vietnam, the 5th Infantry was at Fort Carson, and the 4th was actually up at. It was in the state of Washington before they went to Vietnam. But the armor units were in Texas, most of them. But, you know, that's going back a long way. That's challenging my old memory.
Are there any stories or memories that you'd like to share with us in particular that we haven't really talked about? I'm trying not to prod too hard since there's a lot of, you know, things you can't talk about.
Well, you know, it's one of those things when in the intel field, there are things that you do that you can't really talk about. You never know when it, using my military, my legal, you never know when the statute of limitations is run. You know, you just don't talk about some intel things. You just don't. So I don't know where to go with that. I mean, to tell about that.
When you were in Vietnam, it would seem like because of the nature of your work, you would probably have closer interactions and/or relationships with, you know, the Vietnamese. One, is that accurate? And two, do you think you have a different respect or opinion than maybe a lot of people did who weren't able to have as much, you know, integrated living over there?
It could be. I did have my job involved knowing what was going on in our brigade area of operation. And the way you do that is through the indigenous personnel and ways that we would find out, you know, and running agent nets and that sort of thing. And then just getting to know the people that you had, we had, our brigade was in an area of operation, but there was also a counterpart Vietnamese unit that was there. And so getting to know them and doing things. On occasion, I participated in prisoner of war interrogation kind of things. If they'd capture somebody and we'd go interrogate them to find out things and finding out how the Vietnamese unit would deal with things and how we would deal with things differently, and trying to make sure that you were working together in a coordinated way was kind of sometimes a challenge. But no, I respected the people I worked with a great deal, and frankly, the Kit Carson Scout people, when I was dealing with them, you know, they were the enemy for, you know, that's, they were captured, they were repatriated, they were brought back over. Some of them, the things I learned about what they did was, I thought was very educational for me. I learned a lot about their thinking and about what they had. We had one guy who was trained in Moscow for medical training, but he was captured and he was repatriated, and he was a very bright guy. And he was very open about what he would tell me, and we would make adjustments, you know, based on that. And so if you trust somebody that much, you know, then that says something. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we were right up against a little village just north of our brigade rear area, and it had a little convent there of nuns that were right close by, and they were always worried or nervous or a little concerned. And so we rigged up a telephone communication with them that if they were really scared or if they needed something or if we knew something was going on, then we could call the Mother Superior of this little convent, and we'd go get them and bring them in if we needed to, or help them out. You know, it's just working with the people. That's what you were there for, so, you know, working.
Was any of the intel ever trying to, like, find out where our own, like, MIAs or POWs were?
Well, we were always interested in knowing if they were, if we had anybody captured. You know, that was a kind of a given, only it wasn't something that was extraordinary, you know, just for the unit. It was just anything that we could find out.
That wasn't, like, a particular objective you were, you know, no. It was like if you had the opportunity, you'd do it, but not, you weren't trying to, like, go out and gather information.
No, that wasn't something that we were necessarily assigned to do. It was just a given. That was everybody, whether not just intel, everybody was, you know, if there was anybody captured, we really wanted to know. Well, I brought some pictures along. I just kind of grabbed a bunch before I came. This is my favorite one.
Who was that?
This is my mom and dad's wedding picture.
What year is that?
1943. And they were both in uniform.
So this is well before your dad went to Vietnam.
Oh, yeah. Oh, this was before, let's see. He got out for a short period of time and went back in, and he ended up going to Japan during the Korean conflict. He was a signal sergeant. And then we went from, after he was over there in 1951 and 52, we went to Japan and joined him over there. And that was a great experience. I mean, I was only in the first and second grade. We went to Japan, and like I say, it was during the Korean conflict and or right after it. And went over on the ship, and you know, all these dependents on board a ship going to Japan. This wasn't when they flew everybody all over the place. We went by on the surface. So we went to Japan on the Morton, I think was the name of the ship. And Mom had these two little boys. And then we got there, and we were in Yokohama, Japan. We had a Japanese maid who took care of places, but she took us, Mom and Dad let her take us to the market. I remember vaguely as a little kid in the military, but she took his two little boys, and she was in a kimono, and we'd go out and go to the market with her and everything. And I remember that back then, and even then, it was post-war, close enough. I mean, you know, this is right after World War II, and so I remember seeing some pretty grim things, but that was in Japan, 51, 52. Came back, and we went to, from Japan, we went to Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. And I went to the fourth and fifth grades there, third, fourth, and fifth grades there. And kind of an interesting aside, when I was in Vietnam, I ended up having to go to a convalescent center for a month and a half because I lost the end of a finger. No glorious story. It was a piece of machinery that fell on my hand and that sort of stuff. But the nurse that I had in the convalescent center turned out to be a classmate of mine from the fifth grade at Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. And so she was my nurse in Vietnam. But so we were there, and Fort Leonard Wood. Then from Fort Leonard Wood, my father got assigned to go. That was when he was still in signal. And then he got assigned to go to the new branch of military intelligence, went to school in Baltimore. So we went there, and I finished the fifth grade there. And when he came home one day and he said, "Well, how would you guys like to live in Germany?" Said, "Oh, really?" So he got assigned to Germany. We went to Kaiserslautern, Germany, but we couldn't go directly with him because he didn't have concurrent travel at the time. So we went to stay in my grandparents' summer little cabin in the mountains of Arizona. And I spent the sixth grade down there in this little village in the mountains of Arizona before we went to Germany. And then we went to Germany and were there sixth, seventh, and eighth grades before we came back. We were assigned to Fort Riley. So that was kind of the jumping around kind of thing that we did. But I was always fascinated by it. My brother wasn't so keen on it. He didn't like having to make new friends and that sort of thing all the time, but I thought it was kind of cool that we got to do that.
That explains the Marine Corps.
Probably.
Yeah, like making friends.
So, yeah, he was, he joined the Marines, and my dad just kind of swallowed hard. Dad was Army. I couldn't join anything but the Army because I wasn't going to do that to my dad. but we were all proud of my brother and proud to be a military family. So I've never regretted it. Had a great growing up, great education, and got to do a lot of things. I mean, I've been a lucky guy. A great family and I've gotten to do a lot of really interesting things in my life, and it hasn't been stagnant or stale at all. This is one of my functions. Actually, we had a major in the MI who decided that we needed to have you remember there was an old show on TV called The Rat Patrol? Mm-hmm. Well, he thought we should have a rat patrol, and the only people in the MI that were trained on these machine guns were the lieutenants. So he had us actually going out on two jeeps and go out on rapid reaction force type thing if we had something that happened in our AO. So that's what this was about. And
was it M60?
Yeah. So that was one of those. This is one of my favorite ones. This is when I was in a village doing a cordon and search operation. And these were all the little kids that surrounded me. And part of the reason they surrounded me is because my pockets were full of candy. And, you know, I gave them candy. And I liked seeing the smiles on the kids' faces. So that's what this was about. This was my little sojourn at the convalescent center up on Cameron Bay. This is me with my military picture next to my Jeep that I had that, you know, from our military intelligence. My mother and dad pinning my lieutenant bars on at K-State. Like I say, June 1st, 1968. And then I've got some pictures here that are related more to this is when we were training for Desert Storm. And I took my unit out to the training center out in Barstow, California.
At Fort Irwin?
National Training Center at Fort Irwin. And we were training we had some static displays, but then we were rumbled around a little bit on some Soviet vehicles. And that was kind of fascinating. One minute I'm sitting in a law office in Overland Park, Kansas, and a couple of days later I'm doing this. So anyway.
How did we acquire the Soviet vehicles?
How did we acquire them? You know, I don't know exactly how we got those. I don't know that I'd be at liberty to say if I did, but we had them. You know, we had there were plenty of them out there. There was the op force, you know, that was out there, and the guys who acted as the opposing forces in any kind of military training out in Fort Irwin. And that was And I have another picture here that I think is kind of significant. This was an ROTC summer camp in 1967. And this was a friend of mine in my company. And he and I were friends. He is one of the very, very few African-American members of our company. He's the only one in our company. And I just think it's, you know, it goes along with all the things that are being said today, you know, the differences. But anyway, he and I were good friends back then, and I think it was kind of an unusual thing for this kind of picture probably wouldn't have been very common back then. Mm-hmm. So I'm proud of that picture. So,
are you guys still friends?
I have not heard from him since then. It was, you know, we were friends in the company, and I don't know whatever happened to him. But I've got some stories that deal with interpersonal relationships and that sort of thing. Stories about individuals that I met through, you know, I won't probably go into a lot of those. I don't know how received they'd be today. So. But I grew up in a time that was beginning to change, and most of the time for the good, not always.
Yeah. I would imagine back then it was probably even more difficult than, you know, my era, to keep track of a lot of your military friends. And now we have social media, and that's helped a lot, but, yeah. You know.
Well, we were scattered to the winds. I mean, even our high school friends, you know, we had we had a lot of students in high school. We were all Army brats. Not all of us, but we had the Army brats, we had the townies. The townie kids, I've got a lot of good friends that are here. And I see them and talk to them. I know where some of my old Army friends are, but we're scattered to the winds. Mm-hmm. And if you don't see them on a regular basis, and you don't, you know, social media today, you can keep track of people on Facebook and those sorts of things, and I do on occasion with friends. But it's just not, you know, it's just hard from way back then, and even the people that were in my military units in Vietnam, you know, you'd think you'd stay in touch with them, but I don't know where most of them are. I don't even know if some of them are alive. I mean, I'm getting to be a really old guy, so you just never know. All right, here's a funny, related to Kansas kind of story. One of the things that while I was in Vietnam, I had a young man who worked for me who was from Overland Park, and his girlfriend found out I was from Kansas, and she sent this great big bag of sunflower seeds, the kind you plant, not the kind you eat. And so we got this thing, and I said, well, Dave, what are we going to do with these things? He said, well, I guess we're supposed to plant them. So we planted them all around our little headquarters for the MI in the brigade rear. And so here's all these sunflowers growing up around the, they grew pretty easily. And I put pockets full of sunflower seeds in my, when I went to the forward area. And as I'm whizzing down the highway in the Jeep, I'd throw sunflowers. So there may be sunflowers grown in Vietnam now that are Kansas sunflowers as a result of it. Well, I ended up getting kind of a crazy nickname. And I became Lieutenant Sunflower. And even the general, when I'd go to the briefings at night and give him a briefing, and here's this lieutenant in the back of the room, you know, majors and lieutenant colonels and all these people at the briefing. And the general would say, all right, Sunflower, come on up here and tell us what's going on. And so, now, why did he call me that? Well, partially because of the sunflowers we had, but in Vietnam, you could only bring home two sets of fatigues, you know, the jungle fatigues. When you came home, you couldn't bring a whole bunch of them. You just could only. So when people left, they had all these fatigues that were left. And if they were good, you know, why? What are you going to do with them? So I began collecting them. And I had 33 sets of fatigues. And I'd hang them up in my little hooch that I had. And we had some of the indigenous women would, washerwomen, you know, your hooch maids. And mine was pretty good about washing things in rice starch, so she starched all my fatigues in rice starch, and she'd hang them up, and they'd be hanging up there. The only thing was I didn't change the names on them. And so I'd get a uniform, put it on, and I'd be walking around, and one day I'd be Johnson, and the next day I'd be something else, and people to ask me is, well, I thought your name was Owens. It is. Oh, but you're MI, military intelligence. I said, yeah. Oh, so you can't tell us why you got that on. No, I can't. So a lot of people didn't know my real name because I wore this different uniforms all the time. Well, the general wasn't sure, and so he knew about the sunflower thing, so that's why he called me Sunflower. I was proud of the fact that we came up with a lot of good information that really helped, and briefing the general and then getting that information out was very valuable. And I'd had feedback from people saying, "Hey, thanks for getting that, because we were able to do these things." I also was another little story. Because of the position I was in, people would turn over things to me that they'd capture weapons and all kinds of stuff, and they'd say, here, we can't keep this in our inventory, so you know, can you get rid of it? You're intel. So I'd just put them in our arms room, or I'd take things and put them in there. Well, the pilots a lot of times had trouble having a very large weapon in their cockpit with them. They just couldn't, you know, M15, M16s and that sort of stuff. So they were looking for things. So they asked me if there was any way I could get them something that was smaller. And I ended up being able to scrounge things like, I even scrounged one Thompson submachine gun. I had, people give them to me. I didn't know what to do with them, you know. And so I was able to provide them, the pilots, with these smaller weapons. Believe me, I had no trouble getting a ride on an aircraft whenever I needed one.
I bet.
And so that was, you know, I flew around a lot. I didn't get an air medal because I didn't have quite enough hours, but I probably was getting close. Well, I grew up as an Army brat, and I grew up in a military family, and it's been my life. Even as a civilian in my adult life, it's been very much a part of who I am. And I think sometimes it, I'm not sure everybody always appreciates that, but it's just, I met a lot of wonderful, great people in the military, both, you know, while I was on active duty and before when I was a kid, all through my life, there have been great people. And I have a great deal of respect for veterans and the people that serve, and that's why I don't mind helping veterans out whenever I can. And it's been a good life. And I respect military families. I want to say this. We don't give them enough credit because they serve too. And when you've got, you talked about my dad going overseas and my brother and I being in Vietnam, but, you know, and mom staying at home. They don't get enough credit for all that they do when they stay at home. And my wife learned that. And I had some good friends at K-State who looked after her when she got back to school while I was still gone. And in fact, one of them retired from the Air Force as a lieutenant colonel. He'd gone through ROTC, but he was my roommate at college. And he, while I was gone, he helped with Donna and the baby and the family. And he and his wife are coming to visit us next week. And we've been lifelong friends. But, and he had his dependents too, you know, so they all grew up with military. Mm-hmm. But he wasn't a military brat. He just got into that when he got to K-State. So anyway, yeah, there's just a bond, I think, maybe an unwritten bond among military dependents. And I have a great deal of respect for them. And I'm glad the program here at Johnson County includes not only the veterans, but also the veterans' dependents and people that are connected in that way. And so, anyway, I just wanted to get that in.
Yeah. Well, thank you, and thanks for sharing your story with us today.
I hope it was worth it. I don't know. I don't feel like I said a whole lot, you know. But so, well, thank you, and thank you for what you're doing, and I appreciate what you're doing in Puerto Rico as well. I think that's great. And so, anyway, guys, thank you.